And I looked down there, and I got this nice, big, shiny snowblower right there with me, and thinking, you know, it only take about 10 or 15 minutes. I can go down there and clear out the street in front of his driveway, clear off his driveway for the guy to park. And that's what I should do. I finished cleaning my truck off. I took my snowblower and put it back in my garage and went inside and took a nap while he stood out there stuck in the street. And I look back at that and think, especially yesterday, it's like, my God, what was your problem? That's with your neighbor. He was down there stuck in the street, and what did you do? You, with your little bad, grumpy attitude, turned around, walked back into your house and took a nap in front of the fire. I mean, I'm not proud of it, but that's what I did. And when I started looking at all that, it's like, William, where have you gone? You know, I come every Saturday. I sit at the table and I pray with you guys. And we share our lives. And I realize that here I've been in a spot for a while that I'm not feeling God. I'm not connecting with God. Little things start getting on my nerves. You know, my time in the mornings with God, I get up early because it just works for my schedule while everybody's asleep, and I go and I spend that time with God. I look back, and you know, the last couple of months, you know, I've just been tired. I'll fit God in when I can fit God in, but I'm going to stay in bed this morning because it's cold and I want to snuggle, you know, down under the warm blanket. And as I started that, when I can look back at it now, I can see my reactions to people at work. I can see my reactions to stuff that happened at home. And that was not God coming out. All of a sudden, that was William. He was back. And I didn't pay attention to it. You know, this little thing agitates me here. My wife asks me to do something, and it turns into a fight. You know, I've got two small kids. They do things. They're kids. That's what they do. I'm sure I did 10 times worse than my parents. And all of a sudden, I get upset with them. There was a couple of times at church where some of the people, you know, that I serve with or some of the people down the hall would ask if I was okay, and I'd lie just like I did to Woody, I'm fine. And a couple of weeks ago, one of them said, why don't you just go in there and pray? You know, because they could tell I was agitated with the kids. And actually, it was that same weekend of the snow. You know, we had an extra room. I remember he looked at me and he said, you know, whatever it is, it's not that big. Why don't you go over there and pray? And I knew in my heart, you should go over there and pray and get rid of this. I didn't. I just walked on off and did whatever. And when I look back at that, all those warning signs are there of, William, you're not where you are. You're steadily going down this hill. And I ignored them. And now, coming into, you know, it's not just the fact it's a new year. It's more of the encounter with just lying to Woody in the bathroom and then getting called on it within 5 minutes. That was God saying, you know, you're not going to get away with this. You know, you've been neglecting me, you've been neglecting yourself, and you're not going to get away with it. And you know, I was telling Stephen, I can't come in here and say that, and he said, yes you can, because I do. I owe that apology to each one of you guys, because through the last couple of weeks, yeah, I mean, I'm not proud of it, but I've prayed with other people through their problems. I've listened to their problems. And I've actually went to the Bible and said, well, this is what God says, but I haven't done it myself. And as it gets easier and easier to ignore those signs. I mean, just what Stephen said, just like going down the street, we can drive down a 50-mile stretch of highway and can't recall a sign we saw because we ignored them. Well, I don't want that in my life, and I don't want that for you guys. You can't do that. God puts it out there. He tells you over and over again. What you put in is what comes out. And, you know, that's what I realized, that I was not putting God in. And every time I didn't put God in, something bad came out, and I knew it was wrong. But I didn't stop to go back and see what it was. And that's the important thing, to stop. When that crap starts coming out, I need to go back in. How did it get there? And mine just came from the attitudes, the time I didn't spend with God. They were all there, and I ignored them and kept going down and down. And then, really, when I look back at the last 2 weeks, the thing with my neighbor, it really just brought it all together, because I remember when my wife looked at me. I told her later on, I said, your neighbor got stuck out in the street in that snow. And she looked at me and said, what did you do? Well, I didn't do nothing. And she just looked at me and said, you didn't do anything? I said, no. And that's, you know, she just looked at me, because even before I was ever a believer, if somebody needed something, I would go. I would help. I'd always be there. And then all of a sudden, I had no desire at all to go help someone. So to me, that was really the beginning of, all right, William, what are you going to do? Are you going to follow this road, or are you going to stop and repent and take it back to God? And for all you guys, those little things, they start out little and they turn big. But just pay attention. You know, pay attention to what's coming out of you, because that's what's telling you what is inside. And if you don't put God in the place inside, something else will come out. And that's where I'm at with it. I think that's pretty much sums up where I was. And, you know, again, I do apologize, because I've sat here for a long time and talked to a lot of you guys and just ignored it and let it go. I just ask each of y'all to remember that. What comes out is what you're putting in, or what you're not putting in. Because if you don't put God in there, something else gets in there, and then it comes back out. Because
I really wanted to look back. So the questions for today is, as we start this new year, let's look back at last year. When did you feel the closest to God? What were the things that you were doing when you felt that way? Second question. Did you go through a dry or distant period with God? And you may be in it right now. Can you define the warning signs and what happened? Those two are to be done together. There's a third question. Third question is, how is 2010 going to be different? How can you give more yourself to God? What does that look like to you? And, you know, I think the biggest thing, I've probably got 12 guys in my life that I am the closest to, that I have an intimate, deep relationship with, more than anybody else, that I know what's going on in their lives, that when I see, I can look in their faces and I can tell if they're lying to me. I don't know. Maybe it's just because I know them well, or maybe it's just because God's given me a discernment toward them. But the most important thing that I've found is that I have, our relationship has given me a right to be able to come in and speak truth and to say, help me understand, why are we doing this again? Or why are we here? And as I would challenge you, as we start this new year, find at least one person where you are really open and honest with, somebody that you'll expose all your crap to, and say, I want you to call me on that. When I go to this place, man, I need to call you and tell you I'm there. It's a conversation we've had this week. You need to call me. You need to tell me, or I'm going to have to start calling you. That's where we go. We go and we think, I can do this on my own. And God never intended for it to be that way. So, as we start today, really, really, look hard at these things. You can see the signs. The signs are all out there. It's just a matter of whether we choose to ignore them and obey, or whether we choose to disobey. Those are the only options. Choosing not to obey is disobeying. Hard questions. Hard talk. Okay, 1, 2, 3, go.